Hi everybody, it's Michael, and I'm back with another one of my walkthrough videos. And today I want to show you Francis Drake. Francis Drake is a new game. I got this copy in Essen, but I think there was a Kickstarter before this. It's by Peter Hawes, who has done some games before. I think War of the Roses and also Triassic Terror. It's by, I think it's his company called Kayal Games, but it's published by Eagle Games. The version that I have here is both English and German, and I'll actually show you this towards the end of my video. It's for 3 to 5 players, ages 14 and up, and the box says that it plays in 90 to 120 minutes. Thematically, it's set in the 16th century, where players are sailing for the English crown. They're sailing into, well, New Spain, the Caribbean, and trying to amass as much glory and rich as possible by plundering Spanish galleons, towns, and forts. Mechanically, the game takes place over 3 voyages. Every voyage is pretty much its own thing, so basically almost everything resets from one voyage to another. And each voyage is split into 2 parts. In the first part, you're still in England and you're trying to get provisions, which is a worker placement game with some other mechanics added to it. The second part is where you're actually sailing into the Spanish main in the Caribbean and solving missions, or trying to solve missions, using the stuff that you bought back in England. What I will do now is show you a 4-player game. I will actually only show 2 of the 3 voyages, but nevertheless, that should give you a very good idea of how the game plays. Also, this is a game where you can really benefit by paying attention to what other players are doing and trying to deduce what they are trying to go for, and then somehow consider this in your own plans, either by avoiding them and going somewhere else or by directly going into competition with them. And since I'm playing all 4 players, I will try to highlight that point and hopefully I'll do well. So, have fun watching, and I'll talk to you later.
I have set up a 4-player game, and as always, before we start playing the game, let's take a brief look at the components first. Here we have our main board, and it's divided into 2 parts. Down here we have a map of the Caribbean, and up here we have Plymouth, back in England, where the players will shop for provisions. So let's take a look at that part first.
Here we have 1 ship for each player, and this is the player order for the provisions phase. So the green player will start, and this has been determined randomly at the start of the game. Then we have the various locations where people can go for provisions for the journey. Over here we have an outgoing harbor, so after everybody is done with getting provisions, they will assemble here, and whoever's first then will be able to sail out first. Then we have a scoring track, and everybody starts at the 4th base, and we'll see later why that's the case. Here we have a counter, so of course we start with the first voyage in 1572. And then, as I've already said, we have a map of the Caribbean. What can we see on the map? First of all, it's divided into 4 zones. We have a green zone here, and it costs 1 provision to sail there. Then we have a purple zone, a yellow zone, and a red zone. And the red zone costs 4 provisions. And in these zones we have the various locations that the players can go to. Over here we have 3 different ports where the players can actually trade for commodities like coffee and sugar. Then we have little towns, which are only weakly defended, so they are rather easy to attack. Then we have forts, which are more heavily defended. And then finally we have Spanish galleons, who are accompanied by Spanish frigates and are very hard to attack. What's the goal that the players are trying to achieve in this game? Of course, getting the most victory points. And in this case, victory points represent glory or fame. And there are basically 4 different ways in the game to achieve fame. The first are these commodities. You collect them during the game, and then at the end of the game, count how many different sets you have. So for example, if you have 4 different tiles, that's 26 points. And if you then have another 2, which are also different, it'll be another 8 points. On the other hand, if you have 2 which are the same, it's only 4 points, 2 times 2. Then the second way is to actually attack these various locations. So for example, this 4 will give 4 points, and the ship will give 4 points, and this ship will give 8 points, and this small town will give 1 point, and these points you score during the game immediately after you successfully attacked. Then each location has a gem. Over here we have silvers, then further to the west we have gold, and finally the Spanish galleons carry jewels. And at the end of the game, you just count how many you have of each kind, and they're worth 13 points. Is by diversifying which kind of targets you attack. Again, as a reminder, we have towns, forts, and ships. And after each voyage, so 3 times during the game, you will score points depending on how many different kinds of targets you attack. So if you only attack ships, then it's only one kind, and it's only 1 point. However, if you manage to attack three different kinds, so at least one ship, one fort, and one town, that'll be 10 points. Now, attacking towns is easy because each one only has one Spanish garrison that defends it, and to defend one Spanish garrison, you have to pay or give up one gray crew cube. Forts are a little bit tougher. First of all, the exact amount of garrisons is not known beforehand, so a token will go here, and there are 4 tokens in the game, and they have values 0, 0, 1, 2, and then you add another 2. So overall, the garrison here could be anything between 2 and 4. Also, forts have guns. To successfully overcome a gun, you have to give up one of your cannons, so attacking this fort might be as expensive as giving up 4 crew and 2 cannons. And then the galleons work similar. Each galleon has a basic strength of 2, 1 or 3 cannons, and then each frigate accompanying it can have values of 0 to 2, so defeating this one up here might actually cost up to 5 cannons. So these are the various ways of scoring points in the game. Then over here we have the Plymouth Harbor board. We have supplies, the different kinds of gems, the commodities, trade goods in purple, guns in black, certain tiles like the Informer or the Governor or the Admiral, then gray cubes for the crew, and then Pinesse tiles, Spanish frigate tiles, and Spanish garrison tiles. And then finally, each player has their own player board and player area. Now, the blue player's ship is the Elizabeth, which doesn't matter, it's just the name. And then you have the various storage areas for crew, for the pinnace, for guns, for the commodities, supplies, trade goods, and an informer token. The blue player, since he's last in player order, starts with 1 gun to remedy that in a way. Then each player has 10 of these discs, which are used to mark the locations of Plymouth. Each player also has an investor tile, which you can use once per game. While each player actually starts with a frigate over here on the track, they also have a galleon that they can upgrade their frigate to. Each player has a treasure chest to store all the gems in that he acquires during his voyages. And then finally, each player has mission discs, 4 of them, which are numbered 1 to 4, 1 golden hind, and 1 ghost ship. And then we can already start with the game. So the green player, since he's first in player order, will start by just taking one of his discs and putting it on any location on one of the spaces. Each player can only go on a certain location once, and also we can only put on locations that are further than the last location you put a disc on. So for example, if the green player would go here now immediately, then from there on he always has to move forward, he can't go back. And so the green player just goes here to the crew space, he takes the leftmost spot, so he gets 2 gray crew cubes from the supply. The red player goes to the shipyard immediately. He doesn't bother to hang back with the crew space, so this space means that he can upgrade his frigate to a galleon, and he'll also get a cannon. So 1 cannon for his personal supply, and then he can replace the frigate with the galleon. And a galleon is a prerequisite to actually attack the Spanish galleons. So he's now able to do that, and of course this is a hint to the other players of what he might be planning. The orange player also selects crew. And the blue player decides to jump ahead a little and take 2 cannons. Then we're back to the green player, who decides to also upgrade his ship. The red player takes a cannon. The orange player takes 4 supplies. And 4 supplies mean that he can travel up to here, the last zone. So basically all locations in the game are now fair game for him. And again, the other players can decide to, well, act on that. Now the blue player could go here and also gather some supplies, but this is also possible later on, and so he decides to jump ahead a little to get to the queen. And on here he can also upgrade his ship, but get a cannon and a trade good as well. And the trade goods are needed to actually, well, trade for the commodities. Back to the green player, he decides to take it really slow. Red also gathers supplies, now there are only 2. Orange decides to go to the tavern, where he can roll a die and get the ghost ship, but more preferably crew. And if he uses this first space, he gets a +1 to his die roll. So that is a 4, +1 is a 5, so he gets 3 crew members. The blue player decides to go here on the admiral space, which means he will just gets the admiral counter. And this will allow him 2 things. The one I'll explain later, but the most important thing is that he'll know the positions of the frigates that'll protect the galleons, so he can make a better informed decision on which is easier or harder to attack. The green player collects a supply. The red player also decides to go to the tavern. That's a 2, so he receives a ghost ship. And each player has one, and we'll just move it up a little bit so we know that he can now use that. The orange player has to move somewhere up here, so he decides to take 2 trade goods. The blue player decides to take the remaining one trade good. The green player decides to jump ahead a little and directly go to the Drake space. Now these two circles are intertwined, which means that a player has to put two discs here on two consecutive turns, but first of all he goes here. The red player decides to take the governor space. The governor tile works similarly to the admiral. The governor will know the location and strength of the Spanish garrisons. The orange player takes further crew. The blue player decides to take guns. The green player has to put his second disc on Drake as well. So now he gets two crew and two cannons and then another crew or cannon. And he decides to take three cannons and two crew. The red player takes a crew. The orange player decides to take a pinnace and the first base will also give him a crew. And a pinnace will allow him to circumvent the cannons or guns that are protecting forts, so attacking forts will only cost him crew. The blue player would actually like to get the informant as well, but over here is a supply space and he doesn't have any supplies yet. And without supplies he can't sail at all, so it is too risky for him to go here because then the other players could all go here and then he would have hardly any more chances to get supplies. So he decides to go over here and get three of them. The green player decides to get the second pinnace, the red player decides to get more guns. The orange player actually decides to get the informant and it'll also come along with the trade good. And as the name implies, with the help of the informer, the orange player will be able to get certain informations later on, either on how strong a garrison or a frigate is, or the order of the other player's missions in a given location. The blue player selects the Golden Hind, which is actually Francis Drake's flagship, if I'm not entirely mistaken, meaning that he'll get a fifth mission token, the one with the Golden Hind on it, for this voyage only. The green player decides to jump over this one gun in favor of getting two more supplies, so he now also has three. The red player does something similar. The orange player could go on the investor space, and everybody's allowed to go there, but he's not very interested in it. He could either upgrade his ship, but since he hasn't collected any cannons so far, attacking Spanish galleons is no option anyway. Or he could also get a bunch of things, but he already has some trade goods, and if he doesn't want those to be a total waste, he has to dedicate some of his missions to trading anyway, and for the rest he has enough. So he could either go to the dockside to get either one more supply, which he doesn't need since he already has four, or one cannon, or one more crew, but this is also not really necessary, so he decides to be done with his provisions phase, so he can take his ship and put it on the first free spot in the outbound area of the harbor. Okay, before the blue player can decide on his next action, let's actually take a look at what he might be thinking right now. He has six guns, no crew so far, and three supplies and two trade goods. And he will have five actions because he actually has the Golden Hind. Now let's say that two of these actions will be used for the trade goods, so that leaves him three to plunder something with his cannons. He is the admiral, so he will know the exact strength of each of the three galleons. The galleons have a total strength of six cannons, one, two, and three, and the frigates have another three, that's a total of nine cannons, if he would want to attack and defeat all of them, and he only has six. He could get another two by going to the investor space and choosing this option, and the final one on the dock side. However, he only has three supplies, so he wouldn't even be able to reach this galleon over here, which is in the fourth supply zone. So that's not an option. Suppose he will only attack these two, so that's a total of five cannons, and he can manipulate the frigates so that they are the zero and the one, so that's a total of six cannons, leaving not much room for anything else, but attacking two other galleons would be another two actions, leaving one final action. So the best thing would probably be to just go to the dockside, take another crew, just one crew, and with that he would, for example, be able to attack any town. And that's exactly what he does, so he moves dockside and takes a crew. The green player decides to go on the investor space. You can only do this once per game, and to track that he has to actually give up his investor tile that he received at the start of the game. And you can either choose the upper or the lower side. The lower side will just allow you to upgrade your ship. This is not necessary. The green player already has a big ship. The upper side will either allow him to take two cannons and one crew, or vice versa. And he decides to take two crew and one cannon. And since investors always want something back on their investment, this is represented by having to give up four victory points, which is exactly the reason why everybody starts at four. So it's back to zero or 100. This is removed from the game. The red player does exactly the same, so two crew, one cannon for him. The orange player is already over here, so he has to pass. The blue player is on the docks, so his next move has to be to move over here and to sail out. The green player has one last disc remaining. It would have to go on the dock side unless he wants to sail immediately. And the thing is, the red player is the governor, and the governor will be able to advance one space to the right in sailing order. So even if the green player were to sail immediately, he would be on the three, and then the red player would be last, but he would be able to move up anyway by one space, so the green player would be last anyway. So he decides to take his time, move over here, and take a fourth supply. Then the red player also decides to move to the dock and get another crew, so he's accepting that he can't move into the fourth zone. Orange is skipped, blue is skipped, green has to move over here, red has to move over here, and so the first provisioning phase is done, and we can move into the first sailing phase. Now, the holder of the admiral counter, and that is the blue player, is now able to distribute the Spanish frigates. So, as already mentioned, one has zero cannons, one has one, and one has two cannons, and since he can't go into the fourth zone, it's pretty obvious that he'll place the hardest marker over here, and of course face down, because the others can't know that, and it really doesn't matter too much, but he decides to put the one cannon next to the two, and the 0-1 up here. So now they're both of strength 3, actually, which is maybe the better distribution, because then none of the other players could get lucky and just be able to attack this one down here with just a strength of 2. The red player holds the governor counter, so he's able to do this exact same thing with the 4 garrison troops. And they have a 2 zeros, a 1 and a 2. Again, the red player can't go into the 4th zone, so the 2 marker will go over here. And he decides to put the 1 up here, the 2 zeros here. And here. Then next up, the governor will be allowed to move one space to the right in the outbound dock. So he's now the third to sail out. And then each player will take their fourth marker and mark on the board how far they can go, so it's easier for the others to see. So the orange player can move up to here. Green player zone 4, and the red player zone 3. And then we're ready to sail, beginning with the orange player. Each player has at least their 4 mission discs. Some of them will have the ghost ship, but actually that's only the red player now. And maybe one of them will have the golden hind, that's the blue player. And then the players take turns, placing one of the discs face down so the others don't see the number on any of the available locations. Of course, only up to where they can actually sail. The orange player has 4 missions available. He has 3 trade goods and 8 crew, which will probably allow him to attack at least 2 different targets. So if that's 2 targets and then 3 trade goods, that's already one action too much. So the idea is to maybe try and trade 2 trade goods, that's 2 missions, and then attack 2 targets, preferably different ones. As for the targets, we can go into the 4th zone, and so can the green player. And the green player also has 6 crew members, and he also has a pinnace, so he'll probably focus on forts as well, spending his cannons on something else. And there's one further thing I should mention. While each target can be attacked by a maximum of 2 players successfully attacked. And while everybody scores the victory points, only the first one will actually be able to rob the jewel. And so he decides to take his one disc and put it here, making damn sure that he is the first one to come here, because it's only the 2 of them that can actually go that far. And now, since he has placed his one, the best thing that the green player could do is also place his one, and then he would still go first because of the turn order tiebreaker. Also, this could be a maximum of 4, and knowing that the red player can't even go there, that is probably the 2, but having 8, he's fine with that. The blue player has the golden hind, which actually acts like a 0, so he decides to not place this one first and see how things develop, and just place any other disc. One of his goals is to attack both of these ships. Since orange is earlier but doesn't have any cannons, he doesn't have to fear any competition from there. So he places this one up here to make sure he gets to attack here first. The red player has the ghost ship, which is basically just a bluff. Once everything is turned face up, it'll just be removed. But it allows him to place one more disc than the others, and so we can see where they're going actually. The thing is, you can only place one disc per location, so placing this somewhere where he'd also like to go for real is not a good idea. So he decides to place it up here, where he doesn't intend to go anyway. The green player knows that there's no competition for this ship, but he also knows that this will probably be a 2, so this will cost him 3 of his 5 cannons, and with only 2 cannons left, it's probably too risky to attack any of these. This one is straight out not possible, and if this isn't a 0 but a 1, that's also not good. And so he decides to attack the fort in Cartagena with his 1. The orange player takes his 2 and puts it over here in the trade post in San Juan. He's kind of guessing that he won't be able to get the indigo, which is, by the way, rarest, So there's an equal amount of sugar, tobacco and coffee each, but there's only 3 indigo. But on the other hand, he doesn't want to give up without a fight. With his one crew, the blue player wants to target as lucrative as possible. Can't use any guns, so forts out of the question. It has to be a town. So he decides to go after Gran Granada. And the question is which number to use. And he decides to use his 2. Hoping to get still ahead of the competition down here, the red player places his 1 on this Spanish galleon. The green player decides to put his foot down on Portobello with a 2. The orange player takes his 3 and moves it up here. The blue player now has to decide what's more important to him, getting the jewel down here or getting the indigo over here, because there's now competition in both spaces. He could use the golden hind in any of them to definitely get what he wants, but apart from that he only has 3s and 4s remaining. So the question is what to do. And he decides that he can maybe grab an indigo another time. So he keeps the golden hind to use it later here and puts the 3 over here in Santiago de Cuba. And I'm just realizing that discs should always form a stack. The red player estimates that it'll take him, well, somewhere between 2 and 3 cannons to successfully attack here, which means that he has 2 or 3 cannons remaining. So he could actually go and attack this fort. But the thing is, the green player is already in there, and the best that the red player has to offer is a 2. Yes, he's early in turn order, so if that's actually a 2, then a 2 will do the trick and he'll be able to get the jewel. On the other hand, the other green player's disc is over here, and probably this one is more valuable to him. So he decides to play it safe and put his 2 down here in Panama. And now, of course, the other players start to realize that maybe one of these 3 might be the ghost ship. The green player places his 4. Over here, he knows that there's no competition, but he wants to see how the board looks like in the next round to place his last disc. Orange decides to place his last disc over here. The blue player has already given up on getting the indigo, so he places his 4 over here, but of course the orange player doesn't know what it is. For all he knows, it could very well be the golden hind, and the blue player wants him to think exactly that, because the orange player still has the informer, and now this might be a worthy target for that. But we will see later. Since this town over here is entirely empty at this point and will probably stay like this, the red player decides to put his 4 over here. The green player decides to put his last disc in Panama as well. The orange player doesn't have any discs to place. The blue player still has the golden hind. He decides to put it here, making sure that he'll get the attack on that ship. And now the red player has to decide where to put his 3. So he decides to try his luck over here. And then everybody has placed their discs and we can actually start sailing out to the missions. But first, the orange player gets to use his informer. With the informer, he can either peek under one garrison or a frigate, but this is actually not that interesting to him. He isn't present at any frigate, and he has to use this, you have to be present. Or he can peek under a garrison, but he's actually enough crew to handle any cases, so he'll actually use the other ability. In this one, you can peek under all the discs in a stack in which you are present, so that would be either this one over here, or that one over here, and then after that he can swap any 2 discs and they could be totally different from the one that was in the stack. He decides not to look under here because he's not too keen on getting the indigo. So he's more interested over here because he knows he has the 3, looks at the entire stack, and now he sees that this is no competition for him. And then he can swap any 2 of his discs. Here and here it doesn't really matter because he's alone. Over here he's alone as well. Now the only interesting thing is here. He did place his 2 down before, so he decides to take this and swap it over here with his 1. So unless the blue player has placed the golden hind, this will actually allow him to go first over here now. And now we turn over all the mission discs and place them in order when necessary. And let's look at these cases first. So over here we now have an orange 1 and a blue 4, so orange will actually be able to go first. Here we have a blue golden hind and a red 1, so the blue player will go first. Here we have a ghost ship and 3. Down here we have a blue 2 and a red 3. And down here we have a red 2 and a green 3. And I'll just flip all the other ones. And the ghost ship simply just vanishes. And then each player places his ghost ship disc under his ship in here, so we can actually move the ships away. Yes, that part is not entirely necessary, you could just leave the ships there and resolve the disc just by their numbers. So first of all, the blue player, because he has the golden hind, gets to sail out here and resolve the location. Since it's an attack, we have to flip this one up. We see it's 1 cannon, so to resolve this attack successfully, the blue player would have to give up 3 cannons. He can refuse if he doesn't want to, if he can't, but of course he can, so 3 cannons are gone. He'll get 6 points, so he's now at 10. He'll get the jewel, which you can just put into his treasure chest. And then finally, we can mark that he has successfully attacked the ship category once, which we'll use later on in the category scoring. And after that, we can place our mission disc face down. This is useful because there can only be two attacks on each location. And for example, if there were three discs, then depending on how successful the blue player is, the third attack couldn't take place anymore. And actually leaving the discs there will help us remember that there have already been a number of attacks before. So with the golden hide resolved, every player can sail to their first mission. And then those are resolved in sailing order. So the orange player goes first. Over here, he just has to pay one of his trade goods to the bank. And then he can select any commodity, and of course takes the indigo. And it goes on his board over here. The blue player is up here. He needs three cans again. That's all he can still pay. It's another 8 points, another jewel. But nothing happens down here because he already has a marker in the ship category. The red player is down here. He has to pay three cans. And he also gets 6 points, but no jewel. The green player is down here. So first he would have to pay cannons. But since he has a pinnace, we can ignore that. Then next up is the garrison. That's a zero, so he has to pay two crew. Then he gets the silver, 6 points, and a marker in the fort category. And now everybody can sail their ship to the two location. The orange player doesn't have to pay a cannon because he has a pinnace. So then, as suspected, it costs four crew, but he gets 5 points, the gold, and the marker down here. The blue player has to pay one crew, which he still has. He gets 2 points, the gold, and a marker down here. The red player has to pay one cannon and one crew, but then he gets both the silver and 3 points. And then the green player attacks over here. The orange player doesn't need cannons, has to pay two crew. The blue player gives up a trade good to take a sugar. The red player has to give up one crew to get 2 points and also get the final of the three categories. And the green player gives up a crew for 3 points. Now, if you want, you can actually decide to return home after any mission that you've resolved. And if it's before the end of the fourth mission, you'll actually get 2 points if you're the first to return home, and 1 point if you're the second to do this, the so-called hero bonus. But this is not interesting for any of the players because they still can achieve something with their fourth mission. The orange player takes a sugar, and since this was his mission disc number 4, he returns to Plymouth in the first empty spot, but not getting the hero bonus because he didn't return before the completion of his fourth mission. The blue player takes a coffee and then also returns home. The red player has to give up one more crew for a point and a silver, and he returns home. Finally, the green player has to pay three cannons as expected, gets a jewel, 4 points, and his final missing category. Now, the voyage is scored for everybody. First, you do the categories. The orange player has only one category, so that's 1 point. The blue player has two categories, so that's 4 points. And both red and green get 10 points each. Then the governor, that is a red player, gets 1 point for each silver still on the board. But there is none left. And then the admiral gets 1 point for each gold left. And there's one over here, so that's a point. And yes, probably it would have been wise for the green player to actually attack over here. But, well, mistakes do happen. And this is how scoring looks like after the first round. Red is at 26, green and blue at 25. And orange is at 14. And then we can move into the second voyage, where basically everything resets. Players have to give up everything, except for their commodities, of course, because they will score at the end of the game. And I'll just do that now. And when I say reset everything, that also is true for the ship, so they become frigates again. Resetting everything also includes the Spanish galleons. Now they're again randomly put in a different order. And then we have to determine the new player order. This is based on the victory points, so whoever has the least goes first. So it's first orange, red goes last, blue and green remain at their respective order from the last round since they're tied in points. So it actually looks like this. And finally, we now go to a stack of location tiles. We shuffle those and put them randomly on the first locations up to here, and so the order will be different for the second voyage, and thus we have to adapt our strategies and tactics. So this is our new order of the location tiles, and the interesting thing is that both the guns and the supplies come up right after each other. And then the orange player can already start. The orange player takes two guns, and so does the blue player. The green player decides to take two guns instead of one, and the red player decides that he has time, so he takes one gun Orange decides to upgrade his ship and also take a cannon. Blue decides to take another cannon, and so does red. Orange then takes the informer and a trade good. Blue decides to visit the tavern. That's a 4 with a plus 1, so that's 2 crew. Green decides to upgrade his ship. Red also visits the tavern. That's a 2, so that's the ghost ship again for red.
The green player takes 4 supplies. The orange player takes 2.
The blue player takes 3. Now, despite the fact that he already has 4 supplies, the green player could actually take the 2 over here, just so to make it harder for the other players, but he decides that it's more interesting to get the golden hind instead. The red player decides to take a bit of a gamble and not secure these 2 supplies, but instead go for the one here first, since the orange player is very eager on getting on the Drake's base here, his gamble actually pays off. Then the blue player decides to influence the queen, so he gets to upgrade his ship, gets a cannon and a trade good. The green player decides to take the governor. The red player takes the 2 supplies down here. The orange player has to play another disc on Drake, and he decides to get 3 crew and 2 cannons. The blue player decides to take a pinnace and a crew. The green player decides to take the other pinnace. The red player takes 2 trade goods. Orange takes 2 crew, and so does blue. And green. Red takes 1 crew, and so does orange. Blue decides to take the admiral. The green player has already used his investor, so he can move over to the docks and get 1 more crew. The red player can get the crew over here. The orange player moves to the docks and decides to get 1 more supply barrel. The blue player moves to the docks and now he has to decide what he wants to take. The thing is, he has only 3 barrels for now, and up here is the most valuable galleon. And he's the only one who can actually attack it if he were to take 4 supply, because the green player only has 2 cannons, and that will require at least 3. The red player could still go to the docks, but then he would have to get a 4th supply as well, and then his cannons wouldn't suffice. The orange player has enough cannons, but not a 4th barrel, and he's already gone dockside. So what the blue player decides to take a 4th barrel. The green player moves over here. The red player moves over to the docks, and he decides to take a 3rd cannon. Then the orange player moves over here. Then the blue player, and finally the red player. Now the blue player, as the admiral, can place the frigates, and as we've said earlier, since he's alone over here, he decides to place the 0 there, and then he decides to place the other counters in a way that each of these galleons needs 3, so the 1 here, and the 2 up here, because then he'll shut out the green player with his 2 cannons for sure. Then the green player, as the governor, can place the garrison tiles, since he's both the first player to sail, and he also has the golden hind. That's 2 areas where he can be definitely first. And since he has only 3 crew, but a pinnace, he decides to put the 0s here and here. Then to make these as equal as possible, he decides to put the 2 here and the 1 over here. So at least he shuts out the red player with his only 2 crew. However, on a second thought, he only has 3 crew members. So if, for example, if he were to attack here for 1, because there's a 0 here, and another 1 here, if there were a 0 here, then he would still have 1 crew member remaining to attack a town, and then get at least the 2nd, maybe even the 3rd bonus here. So he actually decides to put the 2 over here, and the 0 over here. And since the green player is already in the first sailing spot, the 2nd ability of the governor is not used in this round. The green player has decided to not go over here, and he placed the 2 here, but the other players don't know that, of course. But since he has 5 missions, including Golden Hind, and he's only able to successfully perform maybe 4 of them, he decides to take his 4 and put it over here, making it seem like he has an interest in this location. The orange player decides that his most interesting target is Cartagena, so decides to place his 1 over here. The blue player wants to try to get that indigo, so his 1 goes into San Juan. The red player places the ghost ship into Panama. Since he only has 2 cannons, the green player thinks that this galleon might be the target with the highest chance of success, so he only puts his 3 there, because he needs his other discs still for the things that have a higher chance of success. The orange player decides that he doesn't want to make it too easy for the blue player to get the indigo, so he puts his 2. The blue player decides to call the green player's bluff over here by placing a disc there as well. The red player sees that both the orange player and the blue player only have 1 trading good, and they're already both in San Juan.
So he thinks that he'll be alone in these two locations, so he could actually go there later. But he's not entirely sure what else he wants to do, so he just takes his four and puts it into Santiago de Cuba. The green player wants to attack a town, and Gran Canaria is the most valuable one. And since he's the first in player order and also has the golden hind, he knows that by placing his one, he'll actually be able to attack here first. And I just realized that I didn't put out the jewels for the galleons, but this is a mistake that is easily fixed. The orange player decides to attack this Spanish galleon with a 3. The blue player still wants to attack this galleon up here, but there's no competition, so he can basically save his 4 for that. And then he also wants to attack a town, so he decides to go over here with a 3. The red player places his 1 into Havana. And now the green player has a decision to make. He wants to attack both Havana and Panama still, and the red player is already there in both locations. The green player has his 2 left and the golden hind. The golden hind will definitely give him the target first. 2 might, but of course not if the red player put his 1 down. So he decides to go for the higher target with the golden hind, meaning that the 2 will be placed in Panama. The orange player still needs to attack a town. There are 2 that are uncontested at this point, but since he only has his 4 remaining, he decides to go over here, hoping that whoever wants to have a town will go over here. The blue player, of course, attacks this galleon with his 4th mission disc. The red player places his 3 disc into Santo Domingo. The green player puts the golden hind into Havana. And finally, the red player would also like to attack a town, and Portobello is still uncontested, so he puts his 2 in there. But then all the missions are placed, so now we can take a look at the informer. The orange player could either take a look under this frigate or this garrison. The thing is, if this is a 2, this will cost him 4 cannons, and then this would be 2 more, but he only has 5, so that would be an option. This garrison, if it would be a 2, then that it would cost him 4, and he needs another crew over here, so for a total of 5. But he actually has 6, so that is not the problem. And the last choice is that he would be able to look under here. On the other hand, he already has an indigo. Yes, it would maybe be nice to deny it to the blue player, but this is actually the more interesting thing. And it's only a 1. What the informer would actually allow you to do if you peeked under one of these tiles, you would be able to withdraw the marker that you placed there and put it somewhere else where you could normally place it. So not on a location where you already are and only up to your supply limit. But since he's fine, he doesn't want to do that. And then we can already start sailing to the missions. The green player is at his golden hind location. This tile is flipped up, it's a 0, of course he knew that. And since he has a pinnace, it'll only cost him 1 crew to get 4 points, the gold, and of course the 4th category. Then down here he has to pay 1 crew. The orange player attacks over here. That's 3 crew and 2 cannons since he doesn't have a pinnace. The blue player gives up a trade good to get the indigo commodity. And the red player gives up 1 crew and 2 cannons to get 4 points. And the 4th category, but the gold is already gone. Now the 2s. The green player gives up 1 crew to get 3 points in the silver. The orange player takes a coffee. The blue player has to give up 4 crew, but no cannons. The red player attacks over here with 1 crew. Number 3. The green player tries to attack over here, and it's 3 cannons, so he's not able to do that. And since his 4th disc over here was only a bluff, he decides to return home early, so he gets a 2-point hero bonus. And his remaining discs are just discarded. The orange player tries to attack over here. He needs 3 cannons, which is exactly what he has left. And then he gets 6 points and the jewel. The blue player attacks over here with his last remaining crew. The red player takes sugar. The green player is already home, so we start the 4th round with the orange player, who attacks over here. He needs 1 crew, and then he gets a silver and 1 point, and also his 3rd category. The blue player attacks up here. He knows that 3 guns will suffice, so he gets 8 points and the jewel, and also his final category. And finally the red player takes a coffee and then also returns home. Then we can score the second voyage. Blue and orange each get 10 points and red and green each get 4 points. And neither the governor nor the admiral will receive any points for leftover silver or gold because it's all gone. That means that the player order is red, orange, green, blue. And then we can reset everything and would move into the third voyage. But I'll actually end the video now and just show you how the final scoring would work. The orange player has a set of 3 different ones, so that is 16 points, and so does the blue player. The red player has 2, so that's 8 points, and the green player has none. The orange player has one red, two yellow and two white. So that's 6 plus 8 plus 5 is 19 points. The blue player has 27.
Green player has 22. And the red player has 9. So the blue player is at 92. The orange player is at 72. The green player is at 62. And the red player is at 53. But of course, there would still be a third voyage.
And this was a four-player game of Francis Drake. Actually, before I wrap this up, let me say a few more words about the components. So I've already shown you how a four-player game works. You just use the tiles on the board, and then for the second and the third voyage, you use these tiles to get a random order.
Now, in a three- and five-player game, you actually have to use the tiles in the first voyage because you have to replace the tiles that are already there. And so, for example, as you can see on the shipyard here, this, well, let's call it a medium hue blue, is representative of the four-player game. Then we have a shipyard in a lighter blue, so that's for a three-player game, and as you can see, there's now only one spot. And the five-player game has a darker blue, and there's now three spots on the shipyard. And of course, in the second and the third voyage, you would take all the tiles and again shuffle them randomly.
And then let me also talk about the German components. There are German components for everything in the game, which is amazing, I think, because let's be honest, there is not so much text on all these components. But if you just flip the board over to the other side, we'll see that we now have orange tiles, and they're called Mannschaft and Werft and Kanonen and Proviant and so on. And also over here we have Reise, down here we have Arten von Eroberungen, and again on the back of, for example, the four-player tiles, we have German versions again in the orange hues. And the three-player orange looks like this, and the five-player orange looks like this. And actually all components are printed on both sides. So for example, ship's log becomes a logbuch, coffee and sugar become coffee and zucker respectively. The informer is now an informant. And also on the Plymouth Harbor board we now have silver, gold and edelstein, for example. And finally the insert, everything fits back in there nicely. There's even a plastic cover to go on top of all that. And there's even an indentation on the side, so you can take out the board without stretching the box.
So, I hope you enjoyed this walkthrough of Francis Drake. Although I showed you only two out of three journeys, I hope nevertheless you got a very good feel for how the game plays, how the rules work, that it's actually not a very complicated game because all the actions are simple, but that a lot of complexity can arise from that. Also, hopefully you've seen now how important it is that you think about what the other players are doing, what they're capable of doing. You have lots of information to kind of deduce what the other players are capable of, where they can go, how many supplies they have, and you can formulate your plans accordingly. There are some discussions online whether this game is actually any good with three, or whether maybe five is the only player count that this should be played with. I only have it played with 4 and 5 players so far, so I'm afraid I have no opinion on the 3 player game. Yes, I enjoy it more with 5 than with 4 players, but I'm not saying that the 4 player game is bad per se. It isn't. Yes, in a 5 player game you have more competition. Basically, you have to be aggressive and go where other people are because that's not enough space. And of course, this adds to the experience because otherwise everybody would just go their own way and there would be hardly any conflict at all. Now, in a 4-player game, yes, it can work out in a way that there is no competition, but on the other hand, nobody forces you to not go into competition. So basically, if you want to be competitive, you can still do that. And that's basically the reason why I think that the 4-player game is still very playable and also plays very nice. Well, it plays faster than with 5 players for once. Basically, it also depends a little bit on the group you're playing with. Either everybody just goes their way and collects whatever they can, and yes, there's of course competition in there, or if players want to play aggressively, they can absolutely do that and go where others already are. So these are my thoughts on that topic. Yes, I guess that's already about it. As always, I thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this, and I hope to see you soon. Bye-bye.